Hello everybody and welcome to this video in which I want to give an overview of the results obtained in the analysis of the continuum limit. You find all the details in the blue book, the Springer book from 2016, in the chapters 3 to 5. Therefore, here I don't want to enter any details, any technicalities. Instead, I want to explain the results and a few ingredients of the proofs, and moreover, I want to make the general concepts clear. In particular, I'm often asked, well, what do you put in? What do you get out? Do you really get out more than what you put in? And therefore, let me explain what the general procedure is. So, what is the input? Of course, we have to do some model building. We have to specify which physical system we want to consider. And to this end, we have to write down the causal Fermion system describing the vacuum. So this means we have to specify the vacuum. And this involves a few free parameters like the masses of the corresponding Dirac Cs. Okay, and also we have to regularize, and there's a lot of freedom to regularize. Good. Next, we want that the resulting causal Fermion system should satisfy the Euler-Lagrange equations of the causal action principle in the continuum limit. So the resulting causal Fermion system should satisfy the Euler-Lagrange equations, let me abbreviate it like this, the Euler-Lagrange equations in the continuum limit and working with regularized Dirac C configuration is already a good idea because then many terms drop out. In other words, the Euler-Lagrange equations are almost satisfied. But not quite. In order to be really satisfied, we need to impose conditions on the regularizations, but only a few such conditions. So we obtain a few conditions on the regularization. And these conditions are more like mathematical consistency conditions, if you like. Of course, the vacuum state should be described by a critical point of the causal action principle, but this is not the case for arbitrary regularizations. We have to impose a few conditions. Nevertheless, these conditions here, so these, they make the whole analysis more difficult to understand because these conditions are a bit technical. Therefore, if you want to see the details, or if you really want to understand how all this works, then I don't see another way than looking into the book, looking at all the details. Good, what do we not put in? So we do not put in how the interaction looks like. Let me point this out. We do not put in the form of the interaction. Instead, the idea is, so the procedure is as follows. Well, we have a critical point of the causal action principle, namely this vacuum causal Fermion system. And then we perturb this finite perturbations and as general as possible. And then we ask the question, well, are the Euler-Lagrange equations still satisfied, yes or no? And this should give us first of all, the structure of the interactions and also the detailed forms of the field equations. And this is the output. So what we get is the structure of the interaction. Well, in the provided that we only consider classical interactions, so on the classical level, let's just write it like here, classical gauge fields. or classical bosonic fields. Okay, then what we get out is that we get chiral gauge fields, left and right-handed gauge fields, and we get the corresponding gauge groups and the couplings. So this means which Dirac particle has which charge, which hypercharge, which weak charge, and so on. And we also get linearized gravity. And also the field, I should here coupling, I should also say one gets here the field equations. So Young-Mills equations, if you like. And we also get like massive gauge fields. But maybe before explaining this, let me proceed step by step. So this is the general structure of the output. So therefore the input is we specify the vacuum. The output is the structure of the interaction and the result, the corresponding classical field equations coupled to the second quantized Dirac field. Good. Well, in the blue book, I proceed in several steps. And this is a good idea simply because the fermion configuration of the standard model is quite complicated. So there are many different elementary particles with different interactions and so on. And I proceeded in three steps. So the first step is, this is done in the third chapter. Chapter 3 of the blue book is that we consider only charged leptons. I will first of all explain it non-technically, and afterwards I will enter a few technicalities, but of course not too much. So we only consider the charged leptons, three generations. So this means electron, muon, tau. And I write down a Dirac C configuration, which I call a sector in one sector, in a Dirac C configuration. Called a sector. So it's basically like the sum of three Dirac Cs, one corresponding to one describing the electron, one describing the muon, one describing the tau. The results for this simplified model is that one gets only an axial gauge field and this axial gauge field is massive. So this means has a rest mass. I'll explain a bit more how this comes about later. Let me first of all state all the results. So there's no gravitational field. There's also no Higgs field. Clearly, this model is too simple, so it doesn't capture all the interactions we have in nature, but nevertheless, it's a first step, and also I develop most of the techniques in this system of one sector. The second step, and this is worked out in chapter 4, is that I consider two sectors which describe all the leptons. So this means I consider the charged leptons, electron, muon, tau, and neutrinos in a configuration which I call like two sectors. Which means that the kernel of the fermionic projector is the direct sum of two sectors. I'll explain this a bit more in detail below. Moreover, we need to assume that in the neutrino sector, the chiral symmetry is broken. So this means that there is an asymmetry between left and right-handed components. And this is part of what we put in. So I mean, this is how we specify the vacuum state. In the vacuum state, there is already this chiral symmetry breaking. And the results for this model is that we get an SU2, a left-handed SU2 gauge field. In the corresponding field equations, there is a mass term. In other words, this is a massive gauge field. And moreover, there is gravity, or more precisely, we get the linearized Einstein equations, linearized gravity. I should say so that this gravity is explained in a separate video. This is why here I don't say much about gravity. So here also the linearized Einstein equations come up and a bit more because it's diffeomorphism invariant. In other words, we get the Einstein equations up to possibly higher order corrections in the curvature tensor, and we also know from the scaling behavior what the corresponding, how the prefactors would scale, how these correction terms actually look like or could look like. Okay, so this is what we get for the system of two sectors. The third step and the final step, and this is worked out in chapter 5, so the last chapter of the book, is that we really model the standard model. So this means we consider, well, all the fermions which are present there, namely, first of all, charged leptons and neutrinos, exactly as in chapter 4. So I mean, there's again a chiral symmetry breaking in the neutrino sector. So this means here we have two sectors just as above. Now we need to include the quarks. And we take one sector for isospin up and one sector for isospin down. And moreover, we multiply it by 3. So we have like 3 copies because of color. So this means we have 6 sectors describing the quarks. This means in total we have 8 sectors. And I will explain a bit more later what this means. If you have several sectors, how does the kernel of the fermionic projector look like, and so on. Okay, so we have such a system of leptons and quarks, but we do not specify how they interact. And this is what comes out. Namely, the result is that there's an effective gauge group. Which is SU2 cross U1 cross SU3, just as in the standard model. The SU2 is similar as in chapter 4. This is left-handed and is massive. So this here is massive. And there's also mixing between the gauge potentials of the U1 and SU2, just as in the standard model with the Weinberg. The Weinberg angle. So this means what we have in total is that we get the Lagrangian of the standard model after spontaneous symmetry breaking. Okay, so in particular, we get the same coupling. So this is also part of what we get. So we get the correct couplings or relative couplings. Let's write it like this. So what I mean by this is that really the electrons have charge, electric charge minus one, and the quarks have this 1/3 and minus 2/3 charges. Collect relative charges. Well, the same for the SU2, it couples to isospin up and isospin down with the opposite sign. The SU3 couples only to the quarks, not to the leptons. It couples independent of the isospin index. So this is what I mean by correct relative charges and couplings. Moreover, one gets again, linearized gravity. And there are also degrees of freedom corresponding to the Higgs field. So this means there are scalar fields corresponding to the Higgs degrees of freedom. However, the field equations have not been worked out yet. Simply because working out these field equations would take on a considerable effort. One has to compute things one order lower on the light cone, which, well, takes a lot of time, and I didn't have the time and courage to do this yet. I'm waiting for a good and ambitious student who wants to do this, of course, with my guidance and help. In any case, so this is like a project for the future. So the field equations for the Higgs field have not yet been worked out. Good, so these are the main results. Of course, I omitted a few details or also didn't say it all. I mean, there you find more in the book, but this is say the main, these are the main results, which I find pretty good because we can reproduce the interactions of the standard model, and also we really do get out more than what we put in. So we need to put in how the fermion configuration of the vacuum looks like, but what we get out is really how the interaction looks like. In particular, these gauge groups here come up automatically or naturally. They come up. It's clear why the left planet is massive. It's clear why the quarks have these certain electric charges. It is clear why the leptons do not couple to the strong field, and so on. Nevertheless, I see the difficulty. It is not so easy to sell this result because we have to impose a few conditions on the regularization. And as I said, these are a bit technical and I can't explain them here. And this is why you need to look it up in the book. But I can assure you that these conditions imposed here, they are not a way of whatever, putting in the gauge group in disguise or anything like that. So these are really just mathematical consistency conditions needed in order to ensure that the vacuum satisfies the Euler-Lagrange equations. And I should also point out here at this stage, we have assumption of the type. We assume that there are non-zero chiral gauge fields. Then the gauge group has to look like this. In other words, we have to make it kind of statement of the form. There should be a sufficiently general interaction, and then it has to look like this. So this is the form of the statement. Good. Now let me explain a little bit more in detail how this continuum limit analysis works. And let me begin with one sector. Of course, for simplicity, and then it will hopefully be clear once you know how this works for one sector, it is also pretty straightforward to generalize it to several sectors. At least conceptually, there's nothing new. Of course, the details, whatever the the work one has to do is considerably harder. Okay, one sector, suppose you want to describe electron, muon, and tau. These are Dirac particles of masses. So we have the three parameters which we need to put in is the rest mass of the electron, muon, and tau. So these are three parameters. And then we have the corresponding vacuum kernel of the fermionic projector, which is as all the time, the Fourier transform of the lower mass shell. So this is again this d4k over 2 pi to the fourth power times k slash plus m times delta of k square minus m square theta of minus k zero times the exponential factor. Okay, and now we have three of these guys. We got one for the electron, one for the muon, and one for the tau. And now the point is that we take the sum. So we simply add them. So this means we take here electron, muon, tau. Let's introduce an index alpha equal 1 to 3. So this is the generation index Pm alpha of x, y. This is how we describe the vacuum in an unregularized way. Now, of course, we need to regularize. There's a lot of freedom here. And I explained this in previous videos. Therefore, let me just put here an epsilon. Okay, and in fact, at this stage, we don't need any further assumption. Writing this down satisfies the Euler-Lagrange equations in the continuum limit. In fact, even more, in the continuum limit, the action vanishes. So this is really a minimizer in the continuum limit analysis. Okay, now of course the question is how to introduce an interaction. And as I said, we do not want to put in the structure of the interaction. And the idea is to be as general as possible and to use the Dirac operator to kind of parameterize the variation of the kernel of the fermionic projector. And to this end, we need to write down a Dirac equation for the kernel of the fermionic projector. But now it turns out to be problematic that we have here a sum. I mean, if you have a sum of Dirac wave functions of different masses, this is not a solution of the Dirac equation anymore. And therefore, as a technical tool, we replace the sum by a direct sum. And this is what I call the auxiliary fermionic projector, P auxiliary of x, y. This is defined by, well, now we take the direct sum, alpha equal 1 to 3 of these corresponding Diracs, and again, everything is regularized. Maybe I should write here comma epsilon. Well, in fact, it's better do it first unregularized and then regularize it later, because otherwise you might wonder, well, do we know that the Dirac equation is still satisfied with regularization, and in fact the answer is no, as I explained before. So therefore, working with the Dirac equation is better to start with the unregularized objects. Okay, now this auxiliary fermionic projector, so this is now for any xy, it's not a 4x4 matrix, but it's a 12x12 matrix, because we took this direct sum. And the advantage is that we can write a Dirac equation for that, namely simply id slash, and we have to put in here a mass matrix m1, m2, m3, which acts of course on the generation index. And this applied to say P auxiliary of xy is equal to 0. Okay, and this mass matrix is what I usually write by m times y. So now we have a Dirac equation. And of course, we have to get back to the kernel of the fermionic projector. So not the auxiliary guy, but the real one. And this is done by taking what I call the sectorial projection. Namely this P of xy is then introduced, well, we simply sum over the generation index for of both bra and cat, alpha beta equal 1 to 3, and then we have here p alpha beta of xy. So this means, in other words, we sum over all the 4x4 block matrix entries. And in this way, of course, then the direct sum becomes an ordinary sum, and we get the kernel of the fermionic projector back. The advantage of working with the auxiliary fermionic projector is that we can now plug in a potential here. So this means we write down the Dirac equation, id slash plus b minus m times y, of course, this should be a minus sign here, minus the mass, acting on, well, this is now the interacting guy, should be equal to zero. And, well, once we know the interacting auxiliary fermionic projector, we can again take the sectorial projection to get back the p tilde. So this means p tilde of xy is again obtained by taking the sectorial projection. Okay, now we have here operator B in the Dirac equation. And we want to vary the system in a general way, as general as possible. And to this end, the B here should also be as general as possible. In fact, one can prove that every variation of the auxiliary fermionic projector can be described by a suitable potential B, or operator B, but this B will no longer be a local operator, but a non-local operator. So this most general is that this B is a non-local operator. Okay, and this is something I analyzed to some extent in the blue book. And what happens if you have a non-local operator, then the singularity structure of the kernel of the fermionic projector is smeared out. It's kind of not surprising. It's something like a convolution which comes up in the perturbation expansion, and therefore the light cone structure disappears. And this is not good, because as a consequence, the Euler-Lagrange equation will not be satisfied, or in other words, we get very large contributions to the causal action, so this will no longer be a minimizer. So therefore, the conclusion here is, if we start with a non-local operator, then the Euler-Lagrange equations will be satisfied only if this B is a local operator, a multiplication operator. Maybe I do it here in quotation marks, because I didn't analyze these non-local operators in full generality. This would have been too difficult. I don't know how to do it. So therefore this, well, here I consider a rather general class of non-local operators and do some analysis. And then the conclusion is, so not really like a mathematically clear conclusion, but I mean, I explain why and give good reasons why that B should be a local operator. In other words, a multiplication operator. Well, and here, with one sector, we have 4x4 matrices, so therefore this B of X is then a general 4x4 matrix. It should be symmetric with respect to the spin scalar product in order to ensure current conservation. And therefore, there is a general ansatz involving left-handed and right-handed gauge fields. Let's write it like this. Plus chi r a slash l. So these are chiral gauge fields. Then there's the possibility of a bilinear potential. Sigma ij, let's write lambda ij. Plus, and there could be a scalar potential. Phi plus, and then there could also be pseudo-scalar potential. So this is the most general ansatz. And then one can analyze all of these potentials in detail. And the conclusion is that the vectorial potential, so if AR and AL are the same, then it all drops out of the Euler-Lagrange equations. So this is the reason why there is no vectorial potential here. So we only get a contribution for the axial potential. So this means if AL is minus AR, and then we really get a contribution on the light cone, which can be evaluated in the continuum limit and all of that. And this gives rise to the massive field equations. Okay, what about this bilinear potential? Well, I computed this and one sees that this doesn't help to solve the Euler-Lagrange equations. On the contrary, you get additional contributions which are very large and therefore must vanish. So I concluded that the bilinear, or like there is no bilinear potential. Okay, and similarly with these scalar and axial potentials, but I didn't really compute this in full detail, as already said earlier, because they show up one order lower on the light cone, and the computations for would take a lot of time to do all these computations. Okay, but the general conclusion is, or what the general procedure is, so we start with a very general ansatz, or the most general ansatz for a local potential. Then we rule out certain potentials, and then we end up with certain gauge potentials. Then we can derive corresponding field equations. Before moving on to the more realistic models, let me explain a few general things in this simple model. The first question is, how does the mass term in the field equations come about? And why is this compatible with local gauge freedom, with local gauge invariance? If you think of Young-Mills theories, then it's impossible to write down a mass term because this would break local gauge invariance. In the standard model, the way out is to introduce a Higgs potential, the Higgs field, and to use the mechanism of spontaneous symmetry breaking. Here, we haven't introduced the Higgs field, so therefore, how is it possible mathematically to get a mass term? And in order to explain how this comes about, I need to consider gauge transformations a bit more in detail. In fact, there are different kinds of gauge transformations. Let me explain this. Okay, so the question here is gauge invariance. And, well, the mass term, massive gauge fields, how do they come about? And first of all, I wanted to mention that a causal fermion system has a local gauge freedom built in. And in this case, the local gauge group is always the isometric group of the spin scalar product. Local gauge transformations of the causal fermion system. So therefore, this is the most fundamental type of local gauge transformations. Maybe what one does is one takes a physical wave function, and they are all transformed to U of x times psi of x, where this U of x is a unitary operator on the spin space Sx. Well, and this is then isomorphic. Well, in the model we are considering right now with spin dimension 2, this is isomorphic to the group U2 2. Okay, in particular, this gauge group U2 2 here, this local gauge group, contains the local phase transformations, which correspond to the gauge transformations of electrodynamics. So this means the U1 is contained in U2 2, Well, and this means, so the corresponding gauge transformation of the wave functions is just e to the minus I lambda of x times psi of x, where this function capital lambda is just the real valued function in space-time. Well, and this corresponds to the transformation where A is transformed to A plus I times the gradient of lambda. This is the local gauge freedom of electrodynamics. So therefore, the local gauge freedom of electrodynamics can be identified with corresponding local gauge transformations of the causal fermion system. And these transformations do not have any physical effect. Namely, the causal Lagrangian depends only on the eigenvalues of the closed chain. The eigenvalues of the closed chain do not depend on these gauge transformations. They are gauge invariant. Accordingly, the Lagrangian doesn't change, so therefore these are really just like local gauge transformations. We do not change the physics of the causal fermion system. Good, so the next question is, what about chiral gauge potentials, which we had up here? So we suppose you have a left and a right-handed gauge potential. In this case, the wave functions are again transformed locally. However, the left and the right-handed component are transformed differently. Suppose now I have this U1 left-handed cross U1 right-handed gauge group. The corresponding gauge potential looks like here. Well, in this case, the wave function is transformed to, well, and then the left-handed component gets a left-handed phase, lambda L of x, plus the right-handed component gets a right-handed phase. And now, just for clarity, I mean, this chi L is the chiral projection operator, so this chi L is 1/2 times 1 minus plus gamma 5. Good, and then of course there is, if you then work out how do the potentials transform, then the left and the right-handed potential are, each of them is changed by the gradient of the corresponding phase function, by the corresponding function lambda L or lambda r. Good. The point is that this unitary transformation, so let's denote it by u of x, this u of x is not unitary with respect to the spin scalar product. In other words, this u of x is not in u of sx. So this is not in our local gauge, in the local gauge group of the causal fermion system. Why not? Let's work this out. Suppose we now take u of x star. So we take the adjoint here. Well, then the point is that the chi L and the chi R, so these chiral projection operators here, so they are not symmetric with respect to the spin inner product, because this gamma 5 star is minus gamma 5. In other words, if we take now chi L star, this is chi R and vice versa. So this means the chirality flips. So therefore, u of x star is chi R times e to the I omega lambda L of x plus chi L times e to the I lambda R of x. Okay, so the whole point is that this left becomes right and right becomes left-handed. And also as a consequence, this u of x is not the same as u of x to the power minus 1. In other words, the local gauge transformations corresponding to chiral gauge fields do not describe symmetries of the causal fermion system, because it's not a unitary transformation of the spin spaces, which can be understood simply as a base change of the spin spaces, but it really changes the physics. In particular, if you now look at the closed chains, for example, here P of xy times P of yx, well, then the phases do not drop out, because like a left-handed component here is multiplied with a right-handed component here, then you get like a left-handed phase and a right-handed phase, and they do not cancel out. So therefore, here in the closed chain, and correspondingly also when you compute the eigenvalues and so on, they depend on the, so these relative phases come up. So here, so and lambda xyi depend on the relative phases. So by relative phases, I mean lambda L minus lambda R. So the difference of the left and right-handed phases. How can this be understood intuitively? So the way I understand it is as follows. So the spin spaces, they are the image of the local correlation operators. And the local correlation operators are obtained by looking at all the physical wave functions of the system. If we consider a transformation here, so like a chiral gauge transformation, then this does not preserve the structures of the spin space, namely like the spin inner product is not preserved. Therefore, this does not correspond to a symmetry of the system, or in other words, this symmetry is broken by the system when the system is formed of all the physical wave functions. In other words, all the ensemble of all the physical wave functions breaks this symmetry to perform independent left and right-handed gauge transformations. Okay, so and well, one should keep in mind the vacuum here is not empty space. Vacuum, these are all these filled Diraxis, and all these wave functions, this is what they break the corresponding chiral gauge symmetry. And with this in mind, the mechanism is quite similar to the spontaneous symmetry breaking in the standard model. So in the standard model, one has this Higgs potential, when then the minimum of the Higgs potential gives rise to a non-trivial field, so non-zero field, and in this way, like this SU2 gauge freedom is spontaneously broken. Here, we also have something non-trivial in the vacuum, namely we have these Diraxis, and they take the same role as the Higgs field, namely they break the local symmetry, and well, then of course one has to work this out more in more detail. What are the resulting contributions to the kernel of the fermionic projector on the light cone, and so on? And then one sees that one actually gets a mass term. Well, and this is not a contradiction, because it fits together with the fact that the chiral gauge transformations are not local gauge transformations of the causal fermion systems. In other words, they do not correspond to symmetries of the system, and therefore everything is perfectly fine. Okay, so this is how this is to be understood. And let me just remark, it's similar in the, well, the bigger model, which incorporates all the fermions of the standard model. And one can understand that this U1 group in the standard model, so this corresponds to vectorial potentials. Well, and in this case, one simply gets here phase transformations, or of the type here. So therefore, the corresponding local gauge transformations, they are in fact local gauge transformations of the causal fermion systems. Therefore, the corresponding gauge fields must be massless. The same is for the strong, for the SU3 gauge fields. They are also vectorial. They correspond to local phase transformations of the wave functions. This is a local symmetry of the causal fermion system, and therefore the gauge fields must be massless. However, for the SU2 gauge fields, we can argue just as here. So, I mean, they are just only left-handed. They only transform the left-handed component of the wave functions. Therefore, these relative phases come up, and this is what gives rise to massive, to the mass term in the field equations. Okay, so this is one point I wanted to point out, this gauge invariance, and how do these massive gauge fields come up. There's another point I wanted to explain, namely I wanted to point out that we get corrections to the field equations. How do they look like? So in other words, one does not simply get like a standard wave equation for, well, in this example here, just for the axial gauge field, but there are corrections, and there are corrections of different type. First of all, there are corrections which are higher order in the Planck length. So this, and these corrections will be extremely small, and I haven't looked at them in detail simply because they are so small that we cannot expect that these corrections can be detected. But there are other corrections which are where not the Planck length comes into play, but the Compton length comes into play, and they could be detectable in principle, and it's one of my main projects for the future to work this out in more detail. Now, how does this come about? And let me explain this, to try to explain this in simple terms. If one considers or looks at the contribution of the Maxwell current or the Young-Mills current to the kernel of the fermionic projector, I mean, I showed this in one of the previous videos, we have something like the current, let's just write it like this, J times, and then there comes this T1. Of course, also an integral and some other prefactor, and the Dirac matrices come up, doesn't really matter. I mean, this is the general structure, and this T1 here has a logarithmic pole on the light cone. The Dirac current, on the other hand, does not come with a logarithm, just a smooth contribution. Therefore, if we want one contribution to compensate the other, and this is how one gets the corresponding field equations, then this does not quite work because this logarithm has a different structure than the smooth term. And therefore, this logarithm has to be compensated by yet something else. And this logarithm is or needs to be compensated well, and this is something, of course, the question is how, and I looked at this in quite detail and tried out several various things, and what I came up with is the what I call the microlocal chiral transformation. And this makes use of the fact that we have several generations. So this works only for, in fact, three generations. So what one does is, so one has these three Dirac seeds, and then one can change the states of the three Dirac seeds in a kind of fine-tuned way. And also in such a way that contributions by the three Cs partly compensate each other. And in this way, one can generate logarithmic poles on the light cone, which compensate for the logarithmic pole of the Young-Mills currents, and what remains is again a non-zero smooth contribution, which can then in turn compensate the contribution by the Dirac current. So this is the general idea here. And what I like about this is that this works only for three generations. So this means this gives a kind of argument why there are three generations of elementary particles. In fact, if there were less than three, say one or two generations, then there would not be enough freedom for really compensating these logarithmic poles, because there would also be terms which would be even more singular, and then the method doesn't work. On the other hand, if there were more than three generations, then the equations would be underdetermined. In other words, there would still be some freedom left, and one wouldn't get the unique way to derive the effective field equations. Okay, and this contributions by this micro-local chiral transformation, this really changes the dynamics of the system. It changes how these particles couple to the gauge fields. So therefore, this is something which could in principle be measured, and this is also discussed in the Blue Book a little bit, but it hasn't been worked out well to the extent that I can really propose you an experiment right now. In fact, there are other effects here, or correction terms, which scale on the Compton scale. And all this still has to be worked out in detail. And as I said, this is an ongoing project. Good, there's one more thing I wanted to point out here, namely that one can even compute the coupling constants. However, the coupling constant depends on the regularization parameters. So therefore, it depends on how we regularize, on the regularization details. But this can be computed for explicit examples. In examples of certain regularization, for example, the cutoff in momentum space or these I epsilon regularizations. And in these cases, I really computed these coupling constants and also the mass of the axial gauge field. And one sees that if one chooses a different regularization, one gets slightly different values for the coupling constant and masses. But generally speaking, I mean, this coupling constant is of the order 1. And this should be thought of as the naked coupling constant, simply the naked mass. So this means this should be the mass and the coupling constant before the corrections due to the self-interaction come into play. Okay. But of course, I mean, as I said, I mean, they can be computed, but they depend on the detailed form of the regularization. This is why we usually take them as empiric constants, but nevertheless, one can check out, well, how big is this constant in typical examples, and then one can really compute it. Okay, I think now let's move on to the system with two sectors. And let me make a few remarks there. I already said that we have two sectors, one with the charged leptons, one with the neutrinos. And what distinguishes the two sectors is that in the neutrino sector, we break the chiral symmetry. So in other words, there's an asymmetry between left and right-handed components. And in fact, this has to be done in a specific way in order to satisfy the order Lagrange equations in the vacuum. And let me explain a bit how this goes, or at least give you a few buzzwords, and then you can look it up in the book. So what we do is that we introduce non-trivial regularization effects. For the right-handed component, of in the neutrino sector, for the right-handed component in the neutrino sector. Okay, in this way, the right-handed component of the neutrino sector looks different from the right-handed component in the charged lepton sector. And what one needs to achieve in this way is, or what the result of this is also, that this right-handed component does not couple or cannot be mixed with the other right-handed sectors. And this is the reason why, if you think of the standard model, why the, for example, the electromagnetic potential cannot couple to the neutrino sector, to the neutrinos. Okay, more technically, so there is this non-trivial regularization effects. There are two which need to be used. One is called general surface states. Which means that the states lie on a general hypersurface, not necessarily a hyperboloid. So this means this mass shell, the form of this mass shell is modified for large momenta, and the states can lie on a surface which can have a different geometry. This is what I mean by general surface states. And then there's an effect called shear of surface states. And combining these two effects in a specific way, so here we have to really, well, make a technical assumption on how the regularization looks like. One can arrange that in the vacuum, the Euler-Lagrange equations are satisfied, and this non-trivial regularization effects also change the resulting interaction by gauge fields. Maybe this is the reason why in this model one only gets here the SU2 left-handed and not the SU2 right-handed. Okay, so this is, and what I find interesting is that these non-trivial regularization effects are also needed for the Einstein equations. So the way I understand this is that apparently in the neutrino sector there is something strange, something unexpected happening in the right-handed component. We don't really know what this is, so this is why I try to work it with in very general terms here. But there should be something which kind of makes it impossible that this right-handed component of the neutrino sector interacts with the other sectors. And if one describes this effectively in the continuum limit, then it amounts to these general surface states and the shear of the surface states. And the resulting contributions to the Euler-Lagrange equations, which one gets again in this continuum limit formalism, they also give rise to the linearized Einstein equations. But somehow the reason is that this coupling constant is proportional to epsilon square. So this means there must be a constant epsilon, the regularization length squared should come up. In the standard formalism of the continuum limit, in other words, without these non-trivial regularization effects, this is not possible because we only get terms of the type epsilon times x minus y vector, which have run a different scaling behavior. So therefore, if one wants to get a coupling constant which is has a dimension, then one needs something non-trivial going on here. Okay, so this is how it's done in the book. And well, I'm not to say, I mean, I would say this is not the final answer. The basic problem is that we do not know enough about neutrinos. So, I mean, there are many question marks because, well, it's difficult to detect them and so on. I mean, so there's a lot unknown about the neutrinos. We don't really know how this neutrino sector looks like. And this is why, for the moment, so the way to get along is to make some general assumptions and then to work out their consequences and then to adjust this assumption in such a way that, well, but at least one gets then two things at once. Namely, one gets really just the left-handed gauge fields, and also this is needed in order to get the Einstein equations. Okay, so this is the present status of this. Now let's move on to the full system, so where we have 8 sectors. As I said, one sector is again a neutrino sector. In other words, it also contains such non-trivial regularization effects. The remaining 7 sectors are identical, so they also have the same masses of the Dirac particles. So in other words, the naked masses of the quarks and of the charged leptons should be the same, but of course the masses change due to the self-interaction. And well, this is a bit similar to what people do in grand unified theories, and apparently this seems to be more or less compatible with the observations. Also, I mean, one could modify this probably. In other words, this is not really the, well, generally speaking, there's some freedom left here. I mean, the way it is written in the blue book and the way it's done right now is that the naked masses of the quarks are the same as the naked masses of the corresponding charged leptons. This means that we have 7 identical sectors, and then there is this neutrino sector, which is different. Okay, but of course, how do we get the distinction between leptons, between charged leptons and quarks? And there is one effect which is called spontaneous block formation. Which has the effect that as soon as chiral gauge potentials appear, say yes. So in other words, as soon as such left and right-handed potentials or gauge phases come into play, then the sectors form pairs. And these pairs is what are called blocks. So this means these 8 sectors form 4 blocks. Then there is one block which contains the neutrinos. This is then the lepton block. Well, and then there are 3 more blocks. They are identical and they correspond to the quarks of the, in the 3 colors. This is also how this U3, then this SU3 gauge group, then mixes these 3 identical blocks. Okay, and then when one has these blocks, then one can work out the effective gauge group in detail and finds the, then one gets this U1 cross SU3 cross SU2. And the SU2 couples only to the left-handed component and so on. So in other words, once one has this spontaneous block formation, then it is kind of a straightforward procedure to work out the gauge groups of the standard model and the couplings and the charges and all of that. Okay, so therefore, I think what I should try to explain how this spontaneous block formation works. What is the mechanism here? And the starting point for this mechanism is what I explained earlier, namely that the relative phases do show up in the Euler-Lagrange equation. So this means the relative phase between left and right-handed component. And now it gets interesting because if we consider the leading order, so the most singular contribution on the light cone, then one simply gets a phase factor. So suppose I write down one of these eigenvalues. Well, and then I get here a phase factor. Let's just write it like this, then it's compatible. Suppose I consider here the left-handed eigenvalue, then I get here, well, let's not worry about here left and right hand any. So I take a specific eigenvalue, so a specific I, or let's call it A, so that we don't get mixed up with the square root of minus one. So we take one of these four complex eigenvalues, and then it gets a phase. And, well, as I explained above, it's the relative phase, so e to the minus I times the difference of the left and right-handed, phase function. Okay, times, and then there comes here, say, let's just call it like this, x, y, vacuum, comma, a. Good, so you could say, well, this phase has no role, this drops out of the causal action, and this is the reason for the absolute value of the eigenvalues. So this phase here drops out of the Lagrangian. In other words, these phase factors again have no influence on the dynamics. However, it gets more interesting if we now go on to lower order in the light cone. So there's another contribution. And now it gets more complicated, so something like other phases, let's write it like this. Times contributions of lower order on the light cone. So what happens here is then, well, if we go lower order on the light cone, then also the mass comes into play. And whenever mass appears, a factor of the mass appears, this changes the chirality. So this means instead of getting this phase factor, maybe we get just a phase factor one because the phases drop out, or maybe we get in different phase factors. I mean, this is something I analyze in detail in the book. It gets rather involved. And well, the general conclusion is that if we have a situation like here, then the left and right-handed gauge phases do not just give an overall phase factor, but we get sums of different phase factors, and as a consequence, also the absolute value changes. So this means that the absolute value of the eigenvalue depends on the phases, depends on these relative gauge phases. And this is why these gauge transformation matrices come up in the Euler-Lagrange equations. We want to arrange, in order to satisfy the Euler-Lagrange equations in simple terms, we need to arrange that all the eigenvalues have the same absolute value, because then these differences, as they come up in the Lagrangian, drop out or vanish. Okay, so this means, well, if you have a phase change, and of course the absolute value does not change, but now if you have additional contributions, they do change the absolute value, and then they have to vanish. And this gives conditions, nonlinear conditions. And these nonlinear conditions have to be worked out in detail. And this, the effect is that of these, well, one starts with a big gauge group, like whatever U7 left, U8 right, not the other way around, U8 left, U7 right, that this big gauge group then reduces to a much smaller effective gauge group. And well, of course, one has to work out the details, and I would recommend you to read these chapters in the book to fully understand how this works. Maybe generally speaking, so we get like matrices of gauge phases, of these relative gauge phases, and then the eigenvalues of these matrices have to have some degeneracies, because then the absolute value of the eigenvalues are the same. So one gets kind of degeneracy conditions for the matrices. And these degeneracies can be arranged or they by choosing the gauge potentials to be the same on the, in the different blocks. So for example, in particular, the weak gauge potentials, they are the same within each block, for each block. So the same for each block. So we have four times the same SU2 gauge potential. And this has the effect that the degeneracy of certain matrices is preserved. And this is what is needed in order to satisfy the Euler Lagrange equations. Okay, I hope I didn't get too technical. Also, I agree. I mean, it's always a bit a problem if one wants to explain technical things without entering the details, then it gets a bit vague. But I hope that nevertheless you got an impression of how this works. And as I said, I mean, I don't see a way out. If you really want to understand it fully, then you should have a closer look at the Blue Springer book. Okay, I think this is enough for this video. I hope you liked it. And, well, see you again soon. Bye-bye.